Let's bring in our panel right now, Laura Wilson, Abdul Hakim-Shabazz, Adam Wren. Adam, a couple things to discuss here, this separation of powers issue, everything that happened at the State House, but also these many other issues that Rokita has involved himself in. Certainly, he's inserted himself on a number of nationally controversial social issues in his time as AG.
Yeah, that's right, Dan. You know, every day I get an email from Newsmax, the conservative-leaning news organization, announcing Todd Rokita's latest appearance on that channel. It sure seems to me like he's preparing himself, if not for a gubernatorial run, at least for a Senate primary where he could face off with a candidate like Governor Eric Holcomb, who will be looking for a job ahead of 2024 when his second term comes to an end.
So perhaps some of the underlying political tension that we're seeing there, there's this back and forth with the governor and the AG that Rokita mentioned there, and also now this situation with the governor and the legislature. They were going to meet Monday with the intention of voting this bill through in just the one day. Now that's been called off. So, Abdul, what happened here?
I found out today from multiple sources, earlier this week, that in a nutshell, there were not enough procedural votes, particularly in the Senate, to go forward, because to do what lawmakers are going to do on Monday, would have to suspend the rules. They need at least a two-thirds vote in both chambers to do it. And apparently a handful of Republicans just were not on board with this. And so therefore, instead of facing sort of embarrassment, Republican leaders in the House and Senate said, hey, you know what? We will put this on hold and we'll just start back up again in January.
Laura, this continues to be a really interesting case study in the separation of powers in the midst of this pandemic. And unfortunately, it's playing out now with cases again on the rise in our state.
It is. And obviously, this is an important public health issue, you know, as a policy. But to the point that you initially made in terms of the constitutional laws, the divisions, the powers, and the questions of what the governor can do, what the attorney general can do, and what the state legislature can do, I think it's really interesting to see this conflict kind of play out, but also to ask ourselves, our state legislature is a part-time legislature. They're generally in office from January to March or January to April, if it is a budgeting year. They don't play that large of a role otherwise in terms of policymaking. And I think some of the questions involve whether or not they ought to and whether or not they have the power to, and what role, of course, the governor plays in all of this as well.
Yeah, and Adam, it's definitely a difficult time for governors who are tasked with leading their state's response to COVID, all the while facing a lot of political heat from those who want to see the state roll back any emergency orders that had been put in place.
That's right, Dan. Indiana has a constitutionally weak governor. And Governor Holcomb, we've seen that he's really sort of taken kind of a backseat to other Republican governors in the Midwest, people like Governor Mike DeWine, sort of modeling what he did during the pandemic. But as time progresses, we're seeing him sort of pull back from that cautious approach and really sort of siding with sort of the right-wing part of his party on some of these issues, which makes me think that he, in addition to Rokita, is making a plan for his future political career after he's governor here in 3 short years.
But again, somewhat of a standoff this past week over these issues. In an op-ed this week, Fort Wayne Journal-Gazette's editorial board said Republican lawmakers had been set to impose regulations affecting our state's public health. They can't claim to be pro-business and can't claim they're listening to anyone other than the loudest anti-vax voices. Abdul, your response to those comments based on what you saw at that hearing on Tuesday?
I think basically Republicans are sort of all over the place. There are some who are listening to the anti-vaxxers, there are some who are listening to business, some just want to do the right thing. And so one thing I did notice, and you said it in the report earlier, that there were only a handful of people actually came out in support of this legislation. The business community, the hospitals were all against it, the strong ideological conservative folks were all against it. To me, this was a no-win situation from day one. And so at least this way, lawmakers can go back, they can take the time necessary to do it right as opposed to do it fast.
We'll see what happens down the road in January. So again, state lawmakers won't be meeting Monday, but the U.S. Senate will be back in session next week. So Laura, let's change gears here and talk about what's happening there in D.C. with the so-called Human Infrastructure Bill. It passed the House, but could still be facing some changes with moderate Democrats in the Senate, again, poised to leave their mark, and another difficult negotiation could be ahead here.
So I think we should expect that, absolutely. And in the first infrastructure bill that did ultimately pass and was signed into law, that was traditional infrastructure. The Democrats are now, you know, reframing. We talk about healthcare, taxes, education, immigration, a lot of other components as a new type of infrastructure. And I think that ideological difference, even within the party itself, is where you see that challenge and resistance between the more moderate Democrats that say, I don't know about the spending, I'm not sure about these policies, is this really infrastructure. And those that are more progressive saying, yes, it reaches into them. Infrastructure itself is usually one of those easy compromises. Yeah. It's something that most people can agree to. And I think using that label in that way is key here.
We'll see how it plays out in the days ahead. Our thanks to the panel. They'll be back coming up. Also ahead, a couple other issues facing state lawmakers, learning loss, and we'll tell you how they're pushing for action after our investigation about the BMV selling your personal information. Stick around. We'll be right back.